Hagrid said that I need to go to platform 9 and 3 quarters, where the Hogwarts Express is. There's platform 9 and there's platform 10. Where in the world is 9 and 3 quarters? Hi there! Having trouble finding the platform? It is my first time too! All we need to do is to walk straight at the wall in between platforms 9 and 10. Easy peasy. Hang on, straight at the wall? Won't we crash into it? Don't worry. Come, I'll show you how it's done. There you go. Come on, let's board the Hogwarts Express. Here's an empty cabin. I'm Ron, by the way. Ron Weasley. I'm Harry. Harry Potter. So, it's true. I mean, do you have the what? Scar. Oh! Hey, what do they have on the trolley? I'm all set. Mom packed me lunch. We'll take the lot. Wow! These aren't real frogs, are they? It's just a spell. Besides, it's the cards that you want. Each pack's got a famous wizard or witch. It says Albus Dumbledore on the card. Who is he, Ron? He's the headmaster of Hogwarts. I've got 6 of him. Hey, he's gone. Well, you can't expect him to hang around all day, can you? Has anyone seen a toad? A boy named Neville has lost it. Oh, are you having chocolate frogs? Let's see what's in them. I haven't got any money, but Harry bought like 30 of them. He's loaded. Do all the students spend their money on chocolate frogs? Assuming that they've got an allowance to begin with, chocolate frogs are nice things to get. If I have an allowance, I'd spend all my money on frogs. Not everyone is like you. What's your name? I'm Ron. He's Harry. Who are you?
I'm Hermione. Hermione Granger. Hello, Harry. Ron, are you saying that the amount of chocolate frogs that a student eats is dependent on the amount of money they have?
That's it, isn't it?
In that case, let's analyze this properly using linear regression.
What's regression?
Regression is a method used to investigate the strength of a relationship between one dependent variable and other independent variables.
So, the number of frogs bought and eaten can be a dependent variable because it depends on the allowance that a student receives.
That's right, Ron. You're assuming that students who receive a higher weekly allowance from their parents will have more galleons to spend on chocolate frogs. That's valid, I guess.
I went around the cabin to collect some data that we can use for linear regression. Take a look, Hermione.
That looks great, Ron. We have 3 columns in this dataset. Student identifiers, weekly allowance, and the number of chocolate frogs eaten per week. First, let's check if the data meets the assumptions of a linear regression.
What are the assumptions, Hermione?
The first is whether the dependent variable follows a normal distribution. We can plot the amount of chocolate frogs eaten using the HIST function.
It looks like a bell shape.
Yes, this means that the observations roughly follow a normal distribution. Then, we need to check for linearity to see whether the relationship between chocolate frogs eaten and allowance is linear. We do this by using the plot function.
The points on the graph look like they're following a straight line.
Yes, this means that the relationship is more or less linear. We can then use the LM function to fit a linear model, and we can use the summary function to explore the results. Here it is!
It doesn't make much sense to me. What did the results say, Hermione?
Let me clean it up using the sum function from the JTools package. Here you go!
Oh, this looks much better now. So we have the dependent variable, which is the amount of chocolate frogs eaten, R square value, P value, and more.
That is correct. The y-intercept value is 0.2, and the estimated effect of weekly allowance on the amount of chocolate frog eaten is 0.71. This means that the average number of chocolate frogs eaten increases by 0.71 for every galleon of allowance a student receives.
The p-value is almost 0. Is that a good thing?
Yes, it is. A p-value of below 0.05 means that there is a significant positive relationship between allowance and the amount of chocolate frogs eaten. We also need to check if the model meets this assumption.
Homocidacity? What's that, Hermione?
It's pronounced as homocidasticity. It means that the data points have the same scatter. We can test this by plotting a graph of residuals versus fitted values. Residuals are the differences between the real values and predicted values. The straight black line represents the predicted values. The blue points are the actual data values. The orange vertical line from the blue point to the black line is a residual. Oh, I see. This makes sense because in the real world, data points do not follow a perfectly straight line. That's correct, Ron. Take a look at this residual plot. The red line represents the average of the residuals, which is centered around zero. This means that there are no outliers that may make a linear regression invalid. Also, check out the QQ plot. In this case, the real residuals from the model form a one-to-one line with the theoretical residuals. Based on the residual plot and QQ plot, we can conclude that the model meets the homoscedasticity assumption. Copy that. Let's visualize the results using the ggplot package in tidyverse. I'm impressed, Ron. That is right. We can use the ggplot function that we learned in the Diagon Alley episode to generate a scatter plot, and the xlab and ylab functions to label the axes. Amazing! Can we add the regression line on the graph, Hermione? Looks like you're paying attention. Indeed, we can use the geomSmooth function to add a red regression line. Wow, nice! How did you know red is my favorite color? Your hair is a bit of a giveaway, isn't it? We can also use the statRegLine equation function to add the equation and R-square value. Remember the result summary that we've seen before? Yes, this graph looks very informative, Hermione. I'm now convinced that the amount of chocolate frogs eaten each week is positively associated with weekly allowance received. Totally! By the way, where's Harry? Did he go hunting for more chocolate frogs? Dunno, let's go find him!